So hello everybody. Very good morning. It's always a little odd, although most of us have got used to it. You are talking to a screen. I'm Jyotsna Jha. I work as Director of Center for Budget and Policy Studies in Bangalore. And a very warm welcome to Dr. Pranab Sen, Professor Vyasulu, who is our president, and Professor M.S. Sriram, who is also one of our board members. So, and all of you who have taken time to join us this morning. And I'll give a little bit of context before handing over to Sriram. We organize an annual budget lecture that many of you have been attending for years now. And it's generally in April, and we organized it a little after the annual budget is presented. The idea is to pick a theme and go for a deeper discussion rather than just like immediate response to the budget. This year, for obvious reasons, we could not do it, and therefore this webinar. And we decided to discuss the issue of the budget itself. There are issues of numbers, there are issues of transparency, there are issues of accountability, and we will discuss it all. Welcome you all. To discuss all this, we couldn't have had a better speaker than Dr. Sen. He doesn't need an introduction. His bio has been circulated. But I'll add one thing that the rigor and credibility of our national statistics are the analysis of that our 5-year plan documents used to have owes that, you know, that rigor comes because of the presence of certain individuals, especially certain economists and statisticians. And Dr. Sen is definitely one of those who is responsible for that. So welcome, sir, once again. And then we couldn't have had a better person than Professor M.S. Sriram to host this conversation. Sriram is a professor with IIM Bangalore and also now a chairperson of the Center for Public Policy. And he's also our board member, and I can tell you from experience that he does ask sharp questions. So, with that, I'll hand it over to Sriram. And please ask your questions in the chat box. And we will try to pass this to Sriram when that starts. And if necessary, we will also allow you to speak depending on what kind of time we have and the questions we have. So, Sriram, it's all yours now.
Thanks a lot, Jyotsna, and thank you, Dr. Sen, for coming in. It's a great honor to be in conversation with you. I see that that privilege is only available to current tapar these days, so thank you for granting it to others as well.
More persistent than anybody else.
But anyway, so let's put the lighter note on the side and get back to the issue. In fact, what I'd like to do in this conversation is divide this up into broadly two parts. One part is to look at the budget process, the sanctity of the budget, and are we losing what the budget is all about? And the second part, of course, is what you love, which are numbers. So what we will do is possibly we'll go on till 40, 45 minutes on this conversation, and then we can take the other questions that are coming. In fact, ideally, we would have loved to listen to you, but this format is, as you only suggested, is much better for a conversation than for a lecture. So let me start with this extraordinary situation that we are in, the post-COVID situation. And you would recall that the finance minister did a 5-day marathon press conference, which was a little bit strange because it was, I mean, it is not very strange because she was announcing a fair amount of measures, partly which are pertaining to the budget, partly some of them which were outside of the budget. But it was almost that it completely bypassed the Lok Sabha, and the fundamental numbers of the budget have changed because of this. So if we were to look at the sanctity of the budget, should she have, you know, given that it's a extraordinary situation, should she have presented a alternative budget, a supplementary budget, as you may have? That's you know, in this situation, what should she have done?
Well, let me begin by giving you the impression I got from what the finance minister did. And the impression that I got was that whatever was being announced was supplementary to the budget. So that the budget numbers, at least in terms of expenditures, would remain at where they were. And these were add-ons being announced. This is the impression that was given. Unfortunately, I don't think that's the case at all. The net result is the issue that you're raising today is completely valid in that, on one hand, we have a whole bunch of proposals that the government wishes to undertake, which do not have the approval of the parliament, hasn't been placed before the parliament either. On the other hand, it's quite clear that there are going to be expenditure items which have been voted upon, which are going to get dropped. The problem is we don't know what that is. So at the present point in time, the budget has become completely redundant to any analysis of the Indian economy. The question there is that do we then interpret the FM's announcement as being the sum total of all the non-committed expenditures of government? Is that what they represent? Because all the committed expenditures, you know, the wages, salaries, pensions, interest, all of that, of course, the numbers will not change in any substantive way, although there are some changes there as well. But the discretionary part of the budget, which is what the parliament actually votes upon, those seem to have been simply left on the side. And we do not know what their status is. All we have heard so far is a statement to the effect that ministries have been told to put all new projects and programs on hold, right? But what happens to the old programs? Do the allocations remain sacrosanct? Are they going to be tampered around? Will the pace of rollout of existing programs change? We don't know. So at the moment, if anybody asked me whether I was able to do any analysis of the government's fiscal stance, my answer would be no, because I simply do not have enough information.
So there are two supplementaries that I'd like to ask on this. One is procedural. I mean, given that it is difficult to call the Lok Sabha and present the budget in the Lok Sabha, what is it that she could have done? Was it possible to have a virtual sitting of the parliament do that? And second is, since these are announcements, we actually don't have a good idea of what is the revenue part of it. And therefore, we really don't, I mean, as you rightly said, we just can't do any analysis or figure out the thing. And by the way, you mentioned this thing about new projects. These were all approved in the old budget, right? So in one way, are we also violating that?
Yes. No, we are. We are. The procedural provisions are that at the point of coming up with a supplementary budget, the government also says that I will fund these additional expenditure items by curtailing approved programs, these approved programs to this extent. So a supplementary budget is more than just a statement of the new heads of expenditure. It's also a statement as to how it is to be financed, right? So procedurally, if one were to treat this as a supplementary, this should have gone to Parliament with an accompanying statement as to how it is going to be funded, in which case we would have had some idea as to what the resource position would be and therefore how much they are planning to reallocate from the existing heads of expenditure.
So is this, I mean, one could always say that this is an extraordinary situation and therefore we can take it as an exception. But do you see this as an exception or a culmination of the way the budgets have been presented in the past few years, particularly given that, you know, the budget speeches, you know, it's long on English and short on numbers. The speeches have been longer and longer, and the format of the finance minister's speech itself has fundamentally changed. And what is being tabled in the parliament during the budget session, I mean, when she actually speaks, she and before that, Mr. Jaitley, is that itself undergone a further change? And do you see this as no surprise? This is where the entire process was moving, or you think that this is an exception?
No. You know, the fact of the matter is that the budget speech has always been, and I see no particular problem with it, has always been a statement of government's intent. It's not necessarily a recounting of what's there in the budget papers. Now, as far as the budget papers are concerned, I think the level of detail has not changed. In fact, in marginal ways, it has improved in certain ways. But the real issue is that if you're making a statement of government intent, can that statement be divorced from what is there in the budget? Because you're quite right, when the finance ministers and Mr. Jaitley also did it, he never said that, you know, we are proposing these expenditures or these taxes for the following reasons. It's really just a general statement, a rather expansive statement of what the government's intentions are. So there's a growing disconnect between the budget numbers and the speech. But in and of itself, one cannot criticize it because the budget speech is really a political statement rather than an accountant statement.
So one significant number that is missing from the budget papers is the statement of revenue foregone. You know,
yes.
That's something because till recently that statement used to come basically indicating what is the impact of the changes of the current budget. And of course, it's a notional number, but not having that number, does it sort of reduce the overall, you know, way in which we could look at the budget? Is that a significant loss of data?
Yes, it is. It is a very significant loss of data because if you really think of the way academics use the budget, the revenue foregone is an important input into trying to assess changes in taxes and tax structures. That's the core data for it. Now, one might say that, look, in the last budget, there was really no dramatic change in taxes, except in customs duties, which went up. But there were no other really significant changes. Perhaps it doesn't matter that much. But the fact is that getting out of the habit of giving that number is a bad precedence. Because the way that number was generated is by really asking the various commissionerates as to what are their expectations about the loss of revenue because of a proposed tax change. So you're actually collecting micro information and then you are collating them to give a macro picture. And this was very, very valuable information for anybody working in public finance.
Okay. The other question, have you seen in the past few years any change in the process of consultations, in the process of engaging with people, particularly in how the budget is formulated? Because, you know, I guess there is no fixed format for it, But every finance minister tends to have a series of pre-budget meetings with all the interest groups, whether it's the CIs or the farmers groups or the lobbies that are there. And I would not even look at it as cronyism, but I would look at it as getting inputs from all interested parties in order to take an objective view. So therefore, there is no harm in talking to a large number of people, but has that consultation process itself suffered in the past few years? Because one doesn't get to hear that all the interests have been represented to the finance minister before the budget
process. No, the consultation process continues. I mean, it's not that it doesn't continue. Now, whether the consultations are wide enough or not would require actually just sitting down with the lists of invitees and checking whether they actually represent specific interest groups or are of a broader nature. But you know, the fact of the matter is that all budgets now and before, the formal consultations are one thing, but informal consultations are much more important in terms of what finally goes in the budget. And that's where the crony element comes in that you're talking about. That never happens in the formal consultations. That's always behind the scenes. And that, of course, will continue. And, you know, in our kind of political system, one sees no hope that that's going to end anytime soon. But having said that, there were times, but unfortunately, it was not a regular feature of the transparency, was that the finance ministry would put out the so-called minutes of these consultations in the public domain, so that at least we knew what the other interest groups had said. That has completely stopped. It hasn't happened in the last 5 years. Right? Now, that's important information because, you know, I've been going to some of these consultations as an economist. So I'm giving the academic, the technical part of it. But I have absolutely no idea what the industrialists have said. I have no idea what the farmers have said. I have no idea what the financial sector guys are talking about, so that I cannot even respond if need be. So that, in a sense, weakens the debate, as it were, and perhaps weakens the impact of the consultations.
Yeah, I mean, of course, as a technical person, you could calibrate your response after having understood some of these.
That's right. And one needs to, because one doesn't have that information. And we don't necessarily get to hear them. And these minutes of the consultations were very valuable documents.
So let me move to one more very significant change that has happened, which is the GST. And ask, you know, what is the, I mean, and therefore is budget important at all? Because if a significant part of your taxation is going to come from indirect taxes, which is GST, and of course, and if we also implement the direct taxes code DTC, then all that we have is only expenditure, and revenue itself, apart from customs and some of these other bits and pieces, borrowing and other bits and pieces which are not there. So, in that sense, the budget itself has now become a continuous process. In terms of at least revenue raising, because the GST Council can keep calibrating it every time it meets, isn't it? And so therefore, both the lobby groups, which are basically lobbying for taxation frameworks, would lobby with the GST Council rather than the budget. And the debate in the parliament on GST cannot happen.
That's right. That's now constitutionally built in.
Yeah.
Right? Now, but think about what you're saying, Sriram. Now, if I have a situation where tax changes can happen midstream and more than once during the course of the year, because that's how the GST Council feels, then you're going to need to change the way we think about supplementaries. Earlier, we had a fairly fixed system, where taxes used to be decided in the budget. The central government could make tax changes and bring them in front of parliament. And then you had the supplementaries being done in November. A single day, that was the time for supplementaries, end of story. But now with GST changing, which means that your revenue base can change, you will need to have supplementaries more frequently. At least I would say that under the circumstances, there should be provision in every session of parliament for a supplementary presentation, if the government so thinks necessary, rather than have this just one point of time, because again, that creates too high a degree of uncertainty.
Dr. Sen, what do you think about, a couple of things? For example, the Karnataka government at one stage decided to present a separate agriculture budget.
Yes.
We used to have the railway budgets, which were separate. In one sense, having a separate budget for some of these very, very crucial and important sectors gets in a focus that the legislative and the parliamentary focus that needs to be there, and hopefully there will be a debate around it. In fact, if you remember, the long march to Delhi had only one demand, that the parliament sits on 27th sittings and discusses only farmer issues, 3 days each, 9 issues or whatever it is. So in that sense, is it a good idea to, because ultimately it's all the Consolidated Fund of India, but is it a good idea to have these different, at least the most significant verticals in different buckets?
Well, that depends. The standing committees of parliament actually play this role. Right, so all the verticals are actually discussed threadbare in the committees. What Karnataka has done is it's taken it beyond the committee to the full legislature.
Okay.
That's all that has happened. It's not that the legislature was not involved, but it was involved through the standing committees.
So let me move on to the second part, since we've already spent around 22 minutes on this. The second part is about what the format of the budget. I mean, that's something that you would certainly worry about as an academic and as a person who looks at the numbers very carefully. How do we ensure that the budget presents what in accounting terms is called as true and fair picture, which is what we have sort of quite effectively imposed on the corporate world over a period of time because of governance reforms and because of accounting standards, etc. I think it's certainly work in progress, but the amount of transparency that can happen in a corporate account because of accounting standards, wherein they have to reveal their on balance sheet as well as off balance sheet contingent liabilities, that doesn't seem to happen very clearly in the budget. So is there a format in which we can work to ensure that there is greater transparency, and we also know what are the time bombs that are ticking behind the budget? Yeah. Dr. Sen, can you hear me?
I think, Kasidam, there are a lot of, not just a question, also a question of transparency in terms of intent. Now, for whatever reason, we have been in a mode where government accounts are cash-based. So a lot of hiding can be done and has been done repeatedly. The extent of which is increasing almost year by year, which is worrisome. And the only way that you're going to be correcting it, and this is one of two big suggestions that have been on the table for a while, and every government that I know of has resisted it. The first, of course, is to have an accrual statement accompanying the budget. Keep the budget on a cash basis by all means, but have an accrual statement along with it, which at least lets us know what the liabilities of the government are, which are not being provided for, right? because that then helps me do the second thing, which is to have a rolling budgetary system, a 3-year budgetary cycle, and the budget rolls. Now, both of these proposals have been on the table for a long time. Point is, no government likes to do it, because what it requires them to do is to lay all their cards on the table. Otherwise, it can't be done. So I'm not holding my breath that, you know, this is suddenly going to happen. But it would be eminently desirable, and I think it would benefit the government as well. Indeed, I may submit to you, Sridhar, that this is an opportunity. The crisis that we are facing now is an opportunity for this government to take advantage of a crisis of this magnitude and just come clean that budget up, move to a system where you people's confidence in what you're doing go up significantly. Doing it under normal circumstances is difficult, but under the current circumstances, I think we the people will forgive the government a lot of things.
In fact, yes, some of these crises have resulted in very, very interesting arrangements. For example, I don't think the FRBM Act was something that the government would have easily passed. You know,
yes,
they would have resisted that, and somehow it sort of sneaked through, and it's now there as a reality for us.
Yeah.
So, is the international community, like the IMF, World Bank, international lenders, are they not insisting on transparency of the budget? I mean, is there no pressure, like the banks are the Basel, is there no, or does it get covered under the sovereignty sheen that we always have?
Yeah.
I mean, what does the world community think about?
That is the point, which is the reason that the financial sector are, as a whole, is covered under fairly tight regulations in terms of their reporting structures and reporting formats. It happens because the guiding principle in that is that these institutions are fiduciary institutions, and therefore they owe, as a fiduciary, they owe their depositors the transparency that is needed. Whereas in the government, sovereignty can cover a lot of things. So you're absolutely right, it is the sovereignty argument.
Is there a way one can work around this or chip it into the process by adding bits and pieces and take it as a long-term project? I don't know. I mean, even the corporate reporting standards have not improved overnight. I mean, they've they're not in the best of their form in any case. But every scandal seems to say that, okay, let's get back and look at what's happening, and then there's a governance committee, and then they say, okay, now you tell us what you're doing, including things like, if you take an annual report now and see the energy conservation, a whole lot of things which are possibly not even connected to the core of the business which need to be reported. Is there no way that we can put a framework onto the government as a community? I mean, I don't know.
Well, as a matter of fact, the budget speech is usually a collection of statements which are actually very remotely connected with the budget. So, as you say, all sorts of things are revealed when the budget speech reveals them. But that's not the issue. The big issue is for the government to give people the sense of the thought processes that went behind the budget. The budget is ultimately an outcome of pressures, of objectives, of constraints, there are a whole bunch of, and of course, of analytical techniques that you use to bring all of this together. The problem is we have no idea as to what these thought processes are. And a clearer statement of such thought processes would make things a lot better, because then one can have an informed dialogue. At the moment, each of us is really looking at one little bit of a jigsaw puzzle from our own perspective, and we really don't know how it fits into the bigger picture in terms of the strategic thinking of the government.
And what about the states? I mean, should there be an integrated statement which sort of looks at all the states as well as the union budget? Because the states keep presenting their budgets at different points in time, and each state has its own fiscal behavior. I mean, obviously, they are all covered under the FRBM Act, and there are certainly limits. And of course, when we look at some of the state budgets, they have been much more responsible than the union government in terms of their borrowing plan, etc., etc. But is there a possibility of us getting a complete comprehensive picture of how we are doing as a sovereign and integrating the state budgets?
It would be nice if the all budgets, center and states, were coordinated, but the only time we get a sense of what is happening at the national level is when the RBI puts the data together, which happens 2 years later. So we are well behind. That's for academic purposes, analytical purposes, that's very useful. But in terms of being able to intervene either at the central or the state level, it's of no earthly use. So we've got a problem now that if a particular state is doing something which we consider to be deleterious to the interests of the country, we can't even communicate with the center, because these channels simply don't exist. And these need to be created. And that is the sort of thing one was thinking about when we were talking about cooperative federalism.
But what would be the mechanism which, I know, if we were to see that there is an intent to integrate the state budgets and also present a comprehensive sovereign balance sheet, how could that happen? I mean, is there some sort of a process that other countries have worked out and are presenting, or is it something which is unique to us, or is it a global problem? How does it work?
Well, you see, the thing is that we cannot compare ourselves with anybody other than other federated states. Most countries in the world are unitarian states, so it's not fair to compare, because those are really seriously subordinate bodies, local bodies in effect. But in a federated state, again, the issue is the extent to which the powers of taxation or revenue raising is balanced between the federal and the sub-federal. In the Indian case, the balance of taxation powers is so badly skewed that if you look at the state budget, the majority of their revenue actually comes as transfers from the center. Now, if that is the case, to have any kind of a sensible budgeting system in the country, state budgets should always follow the central budget. Quite often, they actually precede it. The center should be laying out that this is what I expect, this is how much I'm going to be able to transfer to you. Now go ahead and tell me how you're going to spend.
But again, I'll get back to the GST question. The state budgets are also pretty meaningless now because they have absolutely no control apart from raising taxes on liquor and fuel. And of course, stamps, registration, property, and other small taxes. And if you're a state like Bihar, where you've imposed a prohibition, or a state like Gujarat, you've lost one revenue stream as well. So in one sense, it's almost become a non-federated state as far as finance is concerned.
Well,
I mean, even though yes, there is a share of the discussion happens.
No, that is true. That is true. But, you know, it also leads to all kinds of other issues. you know, at the moment, the non-federated nature is actually being driven by the fact that it is the center which uniquely determines the borrowing limits for each state, which means that the center is actually in effect defining what the bottom line is, right? The only leeway that you have there is playing around with your estimates of GSDP. Now, what that does is that it gives a very strong incentive to state governments to fiddle their GSDP numbers. Now, if you start doing that, what happens is not only does the budgetary data become questionable, the data on the economy of each of the states also becomes questionable. Then the degree of transparency and accuracy in the system simply goes down, and we are seeing this happening.
So one small bit before I sort of open it up to others for questions. Is that, you know, if you remember a couple of years ago when there was a flood in Kerala, Dr. Thomas Isaac, who was the finance minister, said, look, you should allow me to impose a local cess over and above our GST collections, because GST collections, I have no this thing, but I need this money and I'm not getting central assistance and this thing. So therefore, I am feeling very helpless. Is that an idea that the states should sort of pursue, so that in case of, you know, situations like this, where they're completely constrained by either the benevolence of the union or completely helpless that they can't raise additional resources, if they are able to be a little unpopular and impose certain taxes on their own citizenry, is that an idea that is worth pursuing outside of the GST?
You know, this is the thing. It was an idea that was there when the whole GST discussion was going on. I think we keep forgetting this, that the whole idea of the GST was to set the floor. And then states could put cesses and rates above that floor. You couldn't go below it, because that was then leading to this beggar my neighbor behavior that was happening earlier. Somewhere along the way, that vanished. Now the GST is being treated as a single rate across the board, rather than as a single floor across the country. Okay. And I think it is better to give that flexibility, because otherwise what happens is that in terms of localized problems, the states are forced to come to the center with a begging bowl, and the center's decision as to how much and whether and how much to help would be completely politically driven, rather than being driven by necessity.
So I have one. I have one final question. So if you take the budget and look at it, and if you were to look at defense, pensions, committed, salaries, administrative expenses, and interest rate payments, there's very little headroom for any finance minister to maneuver. If we were to look at some sort of a big bang, you know, movement into a completely different trajectory, is there a way in which we could sort of reduce this fixed, non-flexible expenditure to a smaller this thing and expand the size of the budget in a way, or even do away with some of these expenses to gain flexibility? Could we push some of these off budget?
You know, Sriram, on this, whether you go by the wages and salaries or the interest component of our central budget, they are not that large compared to the global norms. I mean, we have this feeling that they eat up too much of our budget. Yes, perhaps they do. But that's not because that they are too high. It is because our taxes are too low. Okay? So compressing these would by and large be a bad idea. The one element which was getting a little larger than getting uncomfortable was the pension bill. Now, as far as the pension bill is concerned, in any case, you have moved to the NPS,
yeah,
and you've taken care of a large part of that problem. Right? The real issue is on the taxation, that if your revenue sources are not enough, because ultimately these are being driven by your administrative and governance needs of a country of our size, and we are already underspending on those. We are already underspending on defense. So then you have to ask the question that where do I raise the resources to be able to make the other interventions that I need for faster development?
So is there a headroom for raising resources?
So it's a revenue question.
Yeah.
Sorry?
But do we have adequate headroom to raise resources? I mean, should we, I mean, is it in a way making more and more informal sector come into the formal sector and so on? I mean, how, what is
yes, the way? You know, yeah. That is, in fact, the best way to do it, right? You know, historically, if you really look at what countries have done, is that there have been, during their development phase, countries have all run large budget deficits, so that as incomes grow and formalization improves, taxation goes up, and then you can reduce the deficit without necessarily curtailing your critical expenditures. We were going on that path. And then at some point in time, we got derailed. So our tax GDP ratio has actually been coming down rather than going up.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Sen. These are the questions that I had, but I see on the chat box a whole range of other questions that have come up. So while I collate them, I request Professor Vinod Vyasalu to come in and speak a little bit and ask his first question. Thank you, Vinod.
Thank you, Sriram. Good to see you, Pranam.
Good to see you, Vinod.
I haven't met in a long time.
Yes, indeed.
I think the conversation ended at the point that interests me most, the point that really interests me the most, that is the tax revenues are too low. We've been talking far too much about cutting expenditures and not enough. In fact, it almost seems a sacrilege to talk about increasing tax.
Ross Vinod, are you happy?
Yeah.
Okay, so
let me respond to the Vinod, go ahead.
Correctly, the direct taxes to GDP ratio is something like 6 or 7%.
Yes.
Or say 10%. So this is often where even talking about tax increases makes you, you know, Lutyenswala or whatever. I mean, it's completely out. The second thing that comes out is that with the introduction of the GST, while the states have lost some kind of fiscal room, there is no process of consultation for the union budget. I mean, the finance minister may consult FICCI formally, but I don't think there's ever been a meeting of finance ministers of the states as a part of the budget. In a federal structure, I think that should be very important, apart from whatever happens informally outside. So one of the questions I want to ask you is, in the current, quite correctly, we're worried about fiscal deficits, but can one really see an increase in expenditure on food distribution or MNREGA as a stimulus rather than an income support? I mean, I think there are some issues here. While I would say that we must observe fiscal discipline, in the current question, I don't think it's right to call increasing expenditure on, you know, slum rehabilitation, medical care, food distribution as a stimulus, so to speak. I want to know what you think about that.
Well, Vinod, let me start with your last question, which is in terms of how one looks at the measures that the government should be taking in terms of tackling the crisis. You know, there is a big difference between income support, which is a stimulus, mind you. Every income support, whether you do it in cash or you do it in kind, is a stimulus. You have no doubt about it. But those are items where the multipliers are low. Whereas something like slum development or improving the healthcare infrastructure, where the government is directly buying goods and services, is also stimulus, but with much higher multipliers. So if you are concerned about a particular degree of fiscal stimulus working through a multiplier, then you have to have a careful balance between the two forms of expenditure, which is income support on one hand and direct purchase of goods and services by the government on the other. Right? Now, as far as your first issue was concerned, which is in terms of the revenue side, which is extremely important. If you think about the taxation arguments that are made, we just had this situation where this bunch of tax officers, young tax officers, sent a proposal to the government and was sharply rebuked for doing so. Clearly, as you said, taxes are something that the government seems to be hypersensitive about. And I don't understand why. Now, this is a conundrum. That this is a government which likes to spend, but does not like to tax, which is kind of a recipe for disaster.
Yes, that is true. And if you then look at the federal structure, where the union can withhold releases to the states. We also have another kind of problem where the tax power is on one side, the expenditure is somewhere else, and the compression of expenditure at the state level has what I call ill-fair effects that are stark. And there seems to be some kind of imbalance on that. Is there any way by which at least statutory dues cannot be delayed? And if compression has to happen, it should be shared with the union government?
Well, you know, the governments have actually been fairly good with the statutory dues. There has been a problem in the GST sharing part of it. Yeah. But in terms of the transfers from the center to the states through the Finance Commission, the central governments have usually been fairly good at it. But the problem is that a very large chunk of the flow from the center to the states are non-statutory. And that NREGA, yeah. The states make the expenditures up front. Now, when the central government reimburses them is entirely up to the central government. Now, those are the areas where the problems are much larger. Because there is a huge chunk of center to state transfers which are not statutory.
Yeah, I think so, but we have to think in terms of a mechanism by which expenditures on the state list, the union's ability to interfere with those should be limited in some way. I don't know what that mechanism is, but that's a point.
I don't know, because you know, this really, as far as the center is concerned, takes us to the expenditure side.
Yes.
Because these transfers come as revenues for the states, but they're expenditures for the center. Now, in that, the discussion that Sriram and I were having regarding the fact that the central budget is becoming more and more of an expenditure budget, and the expenditure side is becoming more and more opaque, is really where the problem is. So the governments can decide and say that I'm going to cut this particular scheme where the money was going to the state, and the states are not told about it until it happens. And there's no way the states can adjust. So the sanctity of the approved expenditures, that is expenditures approved by the parliament, the sanctity of that is so important for the states precisely because of this reason. And as Sriram was rightly saying, that sanctity is gone.
Yeah, we seem to suffer from the fact that, unlike the Brits, we don't have conventions to support the overall legal kind of structure. I mean, there is an interstate council. It could have handled GST matters, but we set up a separate GST council. And the interstate council has become some kind of a security thing in the Home Ministry. So there are a lot of other larger questions that impinge on this. But at this point, I want to hand it back to Sriram so that he can take questions from others.
Thanks a lot, Vinod. The couple of questions which are Pooja, for instance, Pooja Mini asked, does the Constitution provide for a supplementary budget? What is the defined process? And there's also a related question from Jyotsna, which says, is there a way to connect GST council decisions to the supplementaries? So let's take these two first,
yeah,
then I'll come back.
As I said, I think, Sriram, we actually covered this kind of briefly when we were discussing. Yes, there is a provision for supplementaries. The right way of doing it is that the supplementary budget should be a complete statement of the additional expenditures and the manner in which those expenditures are going to be funded. Which means that any revision that has to take place in terms of expenditures on other heads of account or in terms of the revenue sources should be a part of the supplementary. Right? Now, this would take care of Jyotsna's problem as well.
Yeah. So there's one more from Mr. N.V. Krishna, who used to be our board member till recently. He says there's very little clarity regarding expected revenues this year. And therefore, how can this be handled by the government within the budget framework? Because you don't know what's going to happen. You
know, the uncertainty. No, we don't know. In fact, this is such a special situation. None of us have any idea as to what is going to happen. Because we don't know how the disease is going to play out. We don't know how these partial lockdowns are going to play out. It's become practically impossible to take a call on what's going to happen to our growth. We don't know how the distribution of that growth is going to be across the states. So the uncertainties are large. But the point is that a budget cannot wait for certainty to come. What is expected of the government is that you take a position, state it, that is, this is what we expect. And on the basis of this expectation, we are proposing these steps. As and when things develop and we find that our assumptions are going wrong, we will come back to you with another supplement. As I said, there is nothing in the Constitution which says supplementary can be only once. It can happen every month if you feel like it.
So there's one question about gender budgeting. I mean,
yeah.
Question is that, there was a provision for gender budgeting, but Harshad Krishna is asking this question. It's become largely symbolic. Is it, should we continue? Can you propose a possible framework for that?
You know, the reason, look, I was very much a part of this when I was in government. In the Planning Commission, in fact, I was the one who introduced the gender budgeting. The point is, the gender budgeting is essentially a tool for helping people to organize around gender-related issues. And it gives them the ammunition to take on the government. The problem with the experience with the gender budgeting is that there was simply not enough activism behind the gender budget. Net result is every ministry now treats it essentially as an sort of an ad hoc allocation exercise. Now that's sad. But the fact of the matter is something like this cannot really have its effect without a strong civil society movement which is backing it and asking for it. The way you have CBPS doing it for the budget as a whole, you need that kind of activism, you need that kind of conscience keeping happening for the gender budget as well.
So, there's one more, I mean, this is an interesting question, Somik Mitra, which says, who pays for public health? How much should be paid by whom? I mean, what is the role of the central government and the state government? Basically, that's where the drift is. How much of the, yeah.
Well, you know, constitutionally, health is a state subject. But given what we've been talking about, which is that the states are heavily dependent upon central transfers, whether as tax shares or grants. Now, who shares it, how it is shared, is something that we can discuss. Because remember, at the end of the day, the center will have an X amount of money which can then be spent on various heads, which are all in the state list. Question is, who takes that call? So should we be talking about the center doing, saying, okay, here is the money that I have, I am giving it to every state by the finance commission formula and let the state do whatever it feels like with it. In which case the entire onus shifts on the states in terms of how much it allocates to health. Alternatively, the center can say that, look, the states simply do not allocate enough to health. So what I will do is I will reduce the support I was giving to, let's say, education or to agriculture, and I will increase the allocation I'm giving to states on account of health. Either model can work. Which is the preferred model is something that I think we should be debating. I suspect different states will have a different take on which is a better model.
So there's an associated question. I mean, it's a beautiful supplementary to what you just indicated just now. This is from Pooja Mini. She says that the National Health Mission, health policy indicates that 8% of GDP should go on health. But at the same time, states are unable to spend that sort of expenditure. They possibly don't have the architecture to spend it and they don't have the physical facilities. So it results in a contradiction and sort of even if the center allocates, let's say, a higher health budget, if the state does not have the wherewithal to spend it, then it sort of gets stuck somewhere in between.
No,
it becomes a little bit of a contradiction that you have an intent to achieve something, but...
No, it's not a contradiction at all, Shigam. The reason is that health is a subject where you cannot go on a year-on-year basis. So the concern about Indian public health was expressed in the 9th five-year plan, where we said that we need a 20-year game plan, because that's the kind of sustained lead time that you need to be able to create the institutional capacity. You cannot do it within a five-year plan framework. You certainly cannot do it in an annual budget framework. Okay? Healthcare, in particular, more than anything else, requires a 15 to 20-year time horizon and a commitment by all parties to adhere to that game plan. So what should be done is to take advantage of this and do something like a GST council or a national health council and say, let's put a game plan in place and we all commit to it.
Okay. Here is a provocative question, and I'm sure you've now got quite used to answering provocative questions. This is also from a person who has not identified himself or herself. Will the pandemic become a mere excuse for government to be not transparent?
You know, at this stage, it is difficult to say. The fact of the matter is that the pandemic has raised so much uncertainty. The degree of uncertainty is so high that I cannot even see the government being transparent. Now, whether that then becomes a habit, even when the uncertainty recedes, is something that we will know only in the future.
But are you happy with the level of transparency that was there even before the pandemic?
There is no transparency. When pressures were put, especially if you know the whole issue of below the line items where the government did put out a new statement. So there have been response, but when there has been an articulated demand. So governments don't become transparent just because they feel like being transparent. No government wants to be transparent. The transparency comes only on the basis of sustained demand and sustained lobbying. And that's what we need to organize ourselves for.
So I'll take this as one last question from Jyotsna. It says, deviating from the budgets per se, but though related, what is your view on public spending on public goods, particularly health and education, both in terms of entitlement as well as long-term investment or short-term stimulus? So 3 bits for public spending on health and education.
Okay. Every expenditure at the end of the day is a short-term stimulus, if it is made. In terms of the long-term, what really drives it is the sustained expenditure. Do you continue it or do you use it as a one-off instrument? So this is what I was trying to argue, that in the case of education, there has been some movement in terms of building up a sustained commitment to expenditure, mainly because of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. In the case of health, we don't have something which is similar. So when we are talking about the long-term impact, it is the focus should be on sustainment, whereas the stimulus is what you do now. You buy PPEs, you buy, you know, sanitizers, you buy, you know, whatever. That's short term. But to create the capacity on a permanent basis requires a much longer term commitment.
So I have one last, question from Krishna, NV Krishna, which says that, do you think the government should present its accounts and review of its financial status once in a quarter, like all the corporates do? If not a full-fledged budget, at least some sort of a review once in a quarter.
You know, I would totally support that. In fact, I wouldn't go by quarter. What I would say is that in the first day of every session of parliament, the government should present a statement. Okay, let's not make it quarterly. Let's coincide it with the parliamentary meeting.
So sort of an action taken report that is
presented in front of it. And a status report that these were our assumptions.
Right.
Have those assumptions been violated? Do they have to be changed? If so, how do they have to be changed?
Actually, if you would, Dr. Sen, whatever you have said, when we come to think of it, these are the ones which are going to help the governments much better. It is in their own self-interest, whether it's politically or economic management. I don't see why they don't see the point in this. But anyway, thanks a lot for such a wonderful session. I think we are almost time up. 1 hour is up. Thank you for spending your valuable time with us.
Not at all. I enjoyed it thoroughly.
It would have been nice.
Thank you for being a great host.
Thank you. It would have been nice if we had you in person, but I hope we'll meet you to Bangalore at some point in time for a proper lecture.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Right.